This conference will now be recorded.
So far in AWS, we discussed about servers, computing. We discussed about storage. We discussed about load balancers and auto scaling. Now in AWS, the most important and the fundamental service is VPC. It's very, very important concept and a very fundamental service to know is VPC. What is VPC? What is the full form of VPC? Basically, virtual private cloud. It's a network. It's a network. So first, what is network? What is network? Right. So network is nothing but a group of devices interconnected with each other so that they can communicate with each other. So it can be a wired network, wired, a physical wired network, or it can be a wireless network. Network is nothing but a group of devices that can be a servers, that can be routers, switches, that can be printers, right? Group of devices interconnected with each other so that they can communicate with each other. So in AWS, we are creating a lot of devices. I mean to say a lot of servers. Right? So how we are having a control, how we are getting a control on that servers. So in AWS, there is a service called VPC. VPC is a private subsection. It's a private network of AWS that you can control, in which you will place the AWS resources. VPC is nothing but a private network in AWS that you can control, in which you will place the AWS resources. If you remember, when we are creating a EC2 server, or when we created a load balancer, or when we created an auto scaling group, if you remember, did we selected the network, in which network that server has to be created, our auto scaling group has to be created, our load balancer has to be created, right? So by default, every AWS account has one default VPC. The moment you create a AWS account, right, you will get a default VPC created for us. So you have a full control over who has access to the AWS resources that you place inside your VPC. You have a complete control. You can define the routing, network routing for that devices. VPC allows you to logically isolate AWS cloud. VPC, will you provision logically isolated section of AWS where you will launch the AWS resources. In VPC, we can control our networking environment, IP addressing, subnets, route tables, and all the stuff. Whenever we create an AWS account, a default VPC is created for us, right? If you log into the AWS, whenever you try to create a server, we will select the network, right? If you see, when we are creating a server or when we are creating a load balancer, network. Here you see network. Launch your instance into a VPC. You can create a VPC, select your own IP address range, and you can create a subnets, routings, all those stuff in the network. By default, you get one VPC. But these two I have created, you know, specific requirement. Okay. So if you go to the VPC section, you can see all the details, how many networks, how many VPCs are there in this region, how many networks. VPC, isolated cloud resources. We can isolate our cloud resources like servers, load balancers using VPC, and we can control who can access, who cannot access those devices. If you see, as of now, in this region, Mumbai region, I created three VPCs. I have three VPCs. By default, we'll get one VPC, the default VPC. You can see one VPC is there, default VPC, yes. This is the default one. So VPC has some components, some concepts. VPC has some concepts, subnets, subnets, IGW, route tables, NAT instances, NAT gateway, or NAT instance. Or NACL. So VPC has some components, some concepts in the VPC we need to understand first. VPC is nothing but a network. VPC is nothing but a network. Network. So when we create a VPC, when we create a network, we need to define the range, network range. When we create a VPC, we need to define the network range, your IP range for that network, right? So when we create VPC, we need to define the range, network or IP, basically range, in the form of CIDR. In the form of CIDR. So if you see these VPCs, right, you have some CIDR. This VPC CIDR is this, the below VPC CIDR is this, right? So this is basically the range, network range or IP range for that network. So CIDR basically is nothing but classless inter-domain routing. It's a method, basically it's a method for allocating IP addresses and IP addresses and its routing. IP addresses and its routing. CIDR is basically a method for allocating. It's a method for allocating IP addresses and its routing. If you observe, right, we created a VPC with this CIDR, with this network range. If you observe whatever servers we created in that network, the IP address is within that range. If you see, this is the VPC CIDR. We created some servers in that network. If you observe the IPs, whatever servers we created in that network, if you see the IPs, which will be in the same range. Let me show that. this server networking section, if you see, it is created in this VPC in this subnet. VPC has a subnets. I'll come to that. What is subnet? So in this VPC, in this subnet, it is created. If you see the IP, is it falling under the same range? Are you getting the IPs within this range? Whatever devices you are created, whatever devices you place, right? So this one, the private IPs of the devices is within that range. So when you are defining the network, when we are creating the network, you need to define the range, how big your network should be. Suppose I want to create lot of devices, I want to create lot of servers, I want to place lot of devices in that network, I need to take some range, right? So you have some useful sites where you can calculate subnets, CIDRs, all those things, right? I'll come to that. Now, VPC is nothing but a network. How many IP addresses it can support? One VPC, right? As of now in the AWS, IPv4, if I use IPv4 protocol, IPv4, then it will support up to 65,536 addresses, which means how many devices I can place in that VPC, in one VPC? How many devices? Devices is nothing but a servers. It can be a server, it can be a router, it can be a, printer, whatever it is. 65,536 IP addresses. So when we define the CIDR, we will have in this format, right? Something like this. Just to give an example, something like this. Or it can be something like this. IPv4, 4 digits IP, right? 32-bit IP address. And this one, we call it as CIDR block or subnet mask. Guys, again, there are classifications in the IP address. Class A, Class B, Class C IP addresses. It is more on the networking side, right? Class A IP address, Class B, classifications, IP addresses classification, Class C, right? So here I'm giving IP addresses something like this. This represents the CIDR block. If I give something like this, how many IPs I will get for that network? There are different classifications, guys, IP addresses. Okay, so type A, class A, class B, class C. Now, 0 to 127, the first one, the first digit, right? So this 0 to 127, this first one, if it falls under this one, this falls under which category of IP addresses? This is class A IP address. And if it is 128 to 191, the first one, it falls under class B IP addresses. And if it is falls under 192, to 223. This falls under class C. Something like this. We have a classifications. Under class D, we have a class D also, right? So now if I'm giving something like this, what is the IP class? I mean to say which classification of IPs I am using here? Class B, right? So we have some classifications in the IP addresses that is more on the networking side. I am not covering all that CCNA and the networking concept, but it should be, you know, good to have some, at least some knowledge on the classifications. Now, this one, we call it as a subnet mask or CIDR block. It is 32-bit IP address, right? So this is 0 to 32 here. But in the AWS, we can't give something like this. We can't give 32 or we can't give 14. So it will support the CIDR block. CIDR block should be within 16 to 28. So this will decide how many IPs you are trying to reserve for that network. How many IPs you are reserving for your network. Suppose if I give /16, how many IPs you will get? Basically, there is a formula. 2 power 32 minus n. So 2 power 32 minus n here is basically, what is then here? The CIDR block. The CIDR block here. Right? So 2 power 16. You will get these many IPs for that network. If I define my CIDR something like this. Suppose you want to create a very big network. I want to create a lot of servers in that network. If I give very less CIDR block, I mean to say if I give /28. If I give /28, how many IPs I will get for that network? If I just give /28, based on the formula, 2 power 32 minus 28, 2 power 4, 16. 16. And again, 2 power 4, 16. And again, you can't use all those 16 IPs, right? Again, there is a formula. So 2 power 32 minus n. So if my CIDR block is 2 power 4, basically 32 minus 28, 2 power 4. So 16, but again, in the VPC, in the network, there is a one more concept called subnetting. VPC is nothing but a network. What is subnetting? Subnetting is nothing but a subnetwork. Within that network, you have very big network. You are, you know, splitting that network into a multiple small networks. Into a multiple small networks. We call it as a subnetworks. So in AWS, each subnet will reserve 5 IPs for its internal purpose. Each subnet will reserve 5 IPs for internal purpose. For internal purpose, it will reserve 5 IPs. First 4 IPs in that subnet. First 4 and last 1. It will be reserved. Excuse me. In that case, this is my VPC, CIDR. If I create two subnets in that network, in that VPC, so how many IPs I will be actually available for us? How many IPs will be actually available for us? If I create two subnets, each subnet will hold 5 IPs. Each subnet. If I create VPC and if I has a two subnets, in that case, how many IPs will be available? only 6 IPs, which means can I create more than 6 devices? I mean to say, can I create more than 6 servers in that network? If this is my CIDR, the network CIDR, right? So based on your requirement, how big your network should be, how many servers you are planning to create, you need to design your network. So while creating a network, you are going to define the CIDR. So there is a lot of helpful tools available. Like if you take this one, you can use this one also. Now if you see, if this is my CIDR, how many hosts we are getting? 2^32 minus 16 minus 2, 65,536 minus 2 again. So this many, 65,534. And again, this is your network. If you want to divide this network into a multiple networks, multiple subnets, VPC will have a subnets. So I can divide, right? Here, if I want to create 2 subnets, I can use this CIDR for one subnet, this CIDR for another subnet. In this range only, with this range I can create one subnetwork, with this range I can create one more subnetwork. If I want to create 2 subnets, if I want to create again lot of other subnets, right, I can again divide with this one subnet, with this one subnet, with this one more subnet. So you can divide based on your requirement, like 4 subnets, or you want to create, you can divide into multiple, something like this. If you want to divide more, right? So if I create a subnet, basically, right, this will not be allowed, okay? So from here it will not be allowed. So I can create with this much, one subnet, right? So now if I create a subnet with this range, how many servers, I mean to say, how many devices we can place in that subnet if I create one subnet with this range, right? -5. We need to make it -5, because each subnet will hold, each subnet will hold how many IPs? Right. So you are dividing the subnet. Basically, you are dividing your network into multiple subnets. I'll come to that. So this one, you are splitting into multiple. You are splitting into multiple. Now let me take very simple example. I don't want to make things complicated for you. Suppose I created with this one. I created one VPC with this range. I created one VPC with this range. Now how many IPs? 2^32 minus 28 minus 2. 24 as an example. So 2^8. 256 IPs minus 2. 254. Right? Let's take this way. Now let's consider for now 256. Internally it will use some IPs. Okay, so now for internal purpose it will use, guys, every network or subnetwork will it have a basically gateway, network gateway. In the network, the communication will happen via one device, gateway, right? Network ID and broadcasting gateway, there are internal, it will reserve. So that will be available for internal use. You cannot reuse. Now I have a VPC with this one. Now if I want to create a subnets, suppose my requirement is I want to create a two subnets. I can split this network into a multiple subnetworks. Now I have a 256, right? So I can create two subnets each with 128 IPs. 128 IPs. If I want to create two subnets, I can create a subnets, each subnet with 128 IPs. While creating a subnet also, I mean to say, while creating a subnetwork also, you need to define the CIDR. Suppose if I create, while creating a subnet, if I give the CIDR something like this, the subnet CIDR also something like this, will I able to create a one more subnet? While creating a subnetwork, if I give whatever I have given in the VPC, if I give as is, will I able to create a one more subnet? No, because you are allocating all the IPs to only single subnetwork. So we need to split this into multiple ranges. Now, if I give something like this, for one subnet, if I give something like this, how many IPs I will be getting? 128, right? Similarly, I can give something like this for another network. If I give as is here also, it will overlap because if I give something like this, 172.0.0 to 172.0.0.127, these many IPs will be reserved for this subnetwork. Can I create a one more subnet with again same as is 172.0.0.0/25? Because you already reserved these IPs for one subnetwork. You cannot create another subnetwork also with same range. It will overlap. So if I give something like this, what does it mean? It will be from 128 to 255, because it is starting from zero, right? So 127, 128 to 255. So now, even though we are giving 24 here, if I want to divide that into multiple subnetwork, I need to design this way. I need to plan this way. If I give 24 as is, all the IPs will be reserved for same subnet. Will I able to create a one more subnet if I give something like this as is? No. Now similarly, I can design. Suppose I want to define four subnets. Let me take this one. Now let me give whatever it is. Maybe this doesn't matter. Now this is my network range. So basically two will be internally reserved. One for network ID, another for broadcasting. Now this one. Now, if I want to divide this into multiple subnets, four subnets, what I can do? Divide. 126, 126. Basically, it is reserving internally. Again, it will not be, this many will not be available. Again, it will be minus. Now, can I take this one for one subnet? Can I take this one for other subnet? Now, if I want to create four subnets, if I want to just create two subnets, if I want to just create two subnets, this for one subnet, this for one subnet. You can see here, usable IPs. usable IPs. So this many IPs will be usable. Okay. Now, when I create a subnet also, like this is my VPC CIDR, can I give something else, different range, something like this? Can I give, this is my VPC CIDR, while creating a subnet, can I take other range, something like this? No. Subnet CIDR, subnets CIDR should be subset of VPC CIDR. It should be subset, right? It cannot be a different. Now you can use this simple formula, guys, if you want, right? You can use some useful tools. Javed also pinged one link. I think he has pinged one more link, right? Let me open it. So this one, IP calculator, right? So here it is showing all those things. How many IPs you will get? If you want to plan the subnets, this is very useful tool, right? This one, you can plan your subnets based on your requirement. Okay. Now, this is what I explained as of now. VPC has a subnets. What is subnet? Subnet is a subsection of your network, right? You are again breaking your network into a multiple small networks, that we call it as a subnets, right? So when we create a VPC in AWS, VPC is a regional level service. VPC is a regional level service. It spans on the all the availabilities in that region. You can create a VPC in a regional level that will span across all the availability zones in that region. But when we create a subnet, the subnet will reside entirely within one availability zone. You cannot create one subnet with, you know, multiple availability zones. Suppose if I create a VPC in Mumbai region, how many availability zones we have? Just to give an example, 3 availability zones. So I can plan maybe 3 subnets or 6 subnets, something like this. So now I can create in each and every availability zone, I can create one subnet. In 1A, one subnet, 1B, one subnet, 1C, another subnet. Or in 1A, 2 subnets, 1B, 2 subnets, 1C, 2 subnets. So total 6 subnets, subnetworks, right? But same subnet cannot be, you know, spread into multiple availability zones. The one subnet will entire sit in the same availability zone. Okay. And again, there are two types of subnets, guys. You create how many subnets, that doesn't matter. Primarily, there are two types of subnets. What is that? Public subnets and private subnets. Whether you create 6 subnets, 10 subnets, that doesn't matter. But there are primarily two types of subnets, public subnets and private subnets. What is public subnet? What is private subnet? A subnet which has access to the internet. A subnetwork which has access to the internet. So, if subnet has access to the internet, can we reach the servers or whatever devices it is part of that subnet? Can we access that servers from any network, from internet? So a subnet which is having access to the internet, we call it as a public subnet. If the servers are there in a public subnet, can we access using internet from a different networks also? And server also will have access to the internet. Server also will have access to the internet. We can also access the servers from the internet. So a subnet which has access to the internet, we call it as a public subnet. Or in another way, a subnet which has a route to IGW in the route table. A subnet which has access to the internet, or in another way, what I can say, a subnet which has a route to the IGW in the route table. We call it as a public subnet. So what is private subnet? The name itself is saying private subnet. A subnet which doesn't have access to the internet. It doesn't have access to the internet. In that case, can we access the private subnet servers from any other networks or from internet? The private subnet servers will not have internet. The private subnet server will not have a public IP address. It will have only private IP address. So in that case, can we access those from internet? No. So why we need to create a private subnets? And what, you know, why we need to create a servers in the private subnets, like your database servers or your Tomcat servers or your, not only for database, right? Application servers also will be running in a private subnets only, like Tomcat servers, your Docker servers, Kubernetes servers. Why? Inter-server communication will happen in a public subnet also, but the primary reason is securing your servers and its data. If your server doesn't have access to the internet, will you be able to, I mean to say, anyone will be able to access from different networks? Will they be able to reach the servers from a different networks or internet? No, they cannot reach the servers because it doesn't have internet. So only the servers within that network can communicate with each other. Now suppose, let's take this scenario. You have an application servers, you have an application servers, you have a database servers, you have an application servers, you have a database servers. They are in a private subnet. End user want to access the application. Do you give directly access to the application server for the end user? So end user request will come via load balancer. Load balancer should have a public, right? In that case, load balancer, can I create a load balancer in the public subnet in the same VPC? In the same VPC, can I create a load balancer in the public subnet so that end users can reach load balancer? But these application servers or database servers, if I create in the private subnets, the end users cannot directly access, but the load balancer can route the traffic. If the load balancer, which is in public subnet, will be able to talk to the servers, which is in private subnet, in the same network, in the same VPC. Since they are in the same network, they can communicate with each other. Since they are in the same network, they can communicate with each other. So Private subnet servers will not have access to the internet. We cannot access directly from the internet. The server also will not have access to the internet. Now, let me demonstrate. So much of theory we discussed. But before going to create a VPC, let me tell you what is IGW. We have a one more component called IGW. What is IGW? What is the full form of IGW? Internet Gateway. Internet Gateway. So it's a virtual router. It's a virtual router which will enable the internet connectivity to your VPC. It's a virtual router which will enable the internet connectivity to your VPC. It's a network router. It's a virtual router. Yeah, if the subnets are in different availability zones, they will be able to communicate with each other if they are in the same VPC, same network. Let me explain pictorically so that you can understand easily. Let's take this way. Let's take this way. This is Mumbai region. Within Mumbai region, I can create a VPC. I can create a VPC. So let's take this way. Now this is one VPC. Let's consider this is one VPC. You have some subnets. Let's consider. This is one subnet. It is in 1A availability zone. And this is one more subnet. Let's consider this is in 1B availability zone. And the server in this subnet will be able to communicate with server in this subnet if they are in the same VPC. If they are in the same VPC, local. So since they are in the same network, local network, right? So since they are in the same network, but they are in a two different subnets, subnetworks, they will be able to communicate with each other. Without internet also, they don't need a internet connectivity. So let's consider this is also a private server. This is also a private server. If they are in same different, same VPC, same network, will they able to communicate with each other even though they are in two different subnets? Yes. They don't need an internet connectivity. Since they are in the same network, they can communicate with each other, same VPC. Right? But if this doesn't have an internet access, will I able to directly access this one from a different networks? From outside, will I able to reach this server if it is in a private subnet? No. Unless until you part of that network, you cannot access. Right? Now, you have a VPC. You have a subnets concept. And we have a IGW. Let's take this diagram. This is your VPC. Let's consider you have created a VPC with this range. I'm taking very less range so that you can understand. How many IPs? Total 256. How many IPs? 256. But it will minus 2, but I'm taking, it will not be available for us. Total you will have a 256, but two IPs will not be available for our usage. Now, in this VPC, I created this VPC in a Mumbai region. Now, I want to create a subnets. Without creating a subnets, can I create a servers directly in the VPC? Without creating a servers, I sorry, without creating a subnets, Can I create a service directly in a VPC? No, it will not allow. You have a network, you need to create a subnet based on your requirement. Based on your requirement, you create a subnets, subnetworks. Let's consider, you plan this, you can plan something like this. You have maybe something like this. Multiple availability zones. In Mumbai, you have some availability zones, three availability zones, right? Now, I can plan three subnets or I can plan two subnets. So you have 1A, 1B, 1C. This is 1A availability zone. This is 1B availability zone. This is 1C availability zone. So you can plan maybe three subnets, six subnets, based on your requirement, right? Now again, in each availability zone, I can create a subnet. This is one subnet. I'm just, this is subnet. This is availability zone. So I can plan, you know, I can create some subnets. But while creating a subnet, do I need to define the range for that network subnet also? Can I give a different range? This is my VPC CIDR. This is my VPC CIDR. Can I give a different range? I mean to say this one. Can I give something else for this one instead of 172.0. Something? No, right? So suppose my requirement is to create a three subnets. Or my requirement is to create a six subnets in each availability zone. In each availability zone, one public subnet, one private subnet. Suppose your requirement is something like this. In each availability zone, your requirement says, you know, one public subnet, one private subnet. So I can plan something like this. If it is four, something like this. So you can plan this for one subnet, this for another subnet, this for another subnet, something like this. You can take this one for one subnet, this one for other subnet, this one for other subnet, right? You can plan your subnet ranges. This is your VPC range, network range. Then you can divide this into multiple ranges, subnet ranges. Now, will they be able to communicate with each other? The servers in this subnet will be able to communicate with the servers in this subnet, this one, or this one, or this one. Without internet? Yes, because if you remember, all are in the same VPC, all are in the same VPC, same network, all are in the same VPC. They are local to each other. They are local to each other. Now, there is a one more component called IGW. There is a one more component called IGW. What is IGW in VPC? This, I can call it as a IGW. IGW is an internet gateway. Internet gateway. It's a virtual router. So we have a IGW. Internet gateway. So, our default, you know, our default VPC also will have one IGW. I mean to say, each and every VPC will have one IGW. Only one IGW can be attached to a one VPC. So an IGW cannot be detached from a VPC if there are some active resources in the VPC. IGW is a virtual router which will enable the internet connectivity to your VPC. But without IGW also, the servers in this subnet will be able to communicate with the servers in other subnet, because they are local, network, intranet. Without IGW, the servers in one subnet can communicate with other, you know, servers in other subnets, intranet. But if you want to access the servers from outside, do you need an internet connectivity to the network? So that IGW enables the internet connectivity. So only one IGW can be attached to one VPC. And the most important components in the VPC is routing, route tables. There is a one more concept called route tables. So network routing, route table contains set of rules. We call it as a routes. That are used to determine where the traffic should be routed, where the traffic is directed. So the default VPC also has a route table. Whenever a default VPC is created for you, it will have a route table, it will have a IGW, right? So now in the route table, you are going to define the routing. So in simple words, right, I can say, whatever subnet has a route to the IGW, whatever subnet which has a route to the IGW in the route table, we call it as what type of subnet? Whatever subnet which has a route to the IGW in the route table, we call it as what type of subnet? Public. So it will get the routing network, right? Suppose if this subnet is attached with IGW, in the route table, routing, connected, right? The subnet is going to be connected with IGW if I define the routing in the route table. In that case, will this have an internet connectivity? If I attach IGW to the subnet in the route table, will this subnet get the internet connectivity? So can I call that subnet as a public subnet? Yes. The subnet which doesn't have route to the IGW in the route table, can we call it as a private subnet? Yes. The subnet which doesn't have route to the IGW in the route table, we call it as a private subnet, where it won't have an internet connectivity. So now let me practically demonstrate. Is theoretically everyone is clear, guys? Very, very important concept in the AWS is VPC. So what is VPC? What is subnet? What is IGW? What is route table? You will get a more questions on VPC in the interviews also. What is private subnet? What is public subnet? Without internet, will they able to communicate with each other? So these kind of questions. Now let me demonstrate theory in lab. Now I will create my own VPC. For that one application. So let me go back. To VPC section. From here also I can create. VPC, right? I already have 3 VPCs. If required, I can create one more VPC network, one more network. Now, while creating a VPC, you can mention the range, network range. Something like this. I am creating one VPC to host my application. Something like this. And here the range, I can give something like this. Now if I give, how many IPs I will get for this network? Suppose something like this. 256, but actually 2 will be reserved, right? So this many IPs. In that case, can I create more than these many servers? I mean to say servers or load balancers, whatever it is. Can I create more than this in that network? If this is my VPC rich, no. But if you want to have a very bigger network, if you want to have a very bigger network, you can go with 16 or 20, whatever. If I give 16, this many hosts, right? If I give something like this, 20, I will get this many, or 18, something like this, I will get this many, right? But in the VPC section in the AWS, will it allow me to give 14 or 13 or 10? Will I able to do that? What is the mask range, subnet mask range? It should be 16 to 28. I can give 16 or I can give 18, 19 or whatever, or 24 or 28. But I cannot give again 29, 30. It will not allow. So let me take this much, 24. Okay. So in this case, I'll get this much. Now I am creating a VPC with this range. Now I created a VPC. Now I can create the servers, but do I have a subnets in that VPC? Can I create a servers in that VPC without creating a subnets? Right, if you go and launch the instances in that network. If I go and launch the instances in that network, select the AMI, select the instance type. Now here, we created that network, right? But if you see, do I have any subnets to proceed further? Can I create a servers? Now? No, because we don't have any subnets created. So let me create a subnets. I created a VPC and subnets. You may have a question, sir, already there are lot of subnets here. I already see lot of subnets here, but these are subnets for a different VPCs. If you see, I have a lot of VPCs already here, right? So if you see these three subnets, this one, and this one, this is for which VPC they have the subnets? This is the range of that one, this is the range of this one, right? For this VPC, this is the default VPC subnets. When you try to create a VPCs in the subnets, servers in the VPC in the default, the default VPC has these three subnets. Right? These are for default. And these are for other VPCs. These subnets I have created for other VPCs. Now I can create a subnet here for whatever network I created. Click on create subnet and select for which VPC you want to create the subnet, for which network. I want to create a subnet for this network, right? Now this is your VPC CIDR. While creating a subnet, let me give subnet name as public subnet. I'm just giving a name as public subnet, but it is not a public subnet as of now. Let's follow some standards. Flipkart VPC subnet 1A, something like this. I'm just giving something public, but it is not a public. The name I am giving as a public, as of now, it is not a public. Now I am creating a subnet in this VPC. Can I give something else here? The subnet range. Can I give something like this? Will it allow? This is my VPC range. This is my VPC range. Can I give a different range? Something like this. CIDR address is not within the CIDR address from VPC, which means the VPC CIDR should be subset of your, the subnet CIDR should be subset of your VPC CIDR. So it should start with 192XX, right? It should start with 192. I can give something like this, but here, can I give /16 for my subnet? The VPC itself is this one. I can't make it bigger. Now 24. I can give like this. This is my VPC CIDR. This is my subnet CIDR. I'm giving everything. In that case, will I able to create one more subnet in this VPC if I give everything? No. Now I am planning two subnets. I am planning two subnets. I will divide. Now, can I take this one for one subnet? I am taking this one for one subnet. So, in which availability zone you want to create this subnet? In which availability zone you want to create this subnet? Right? Whether you want to create in 1A availability zone or 1B or 1C, based on your requirement, I'll say 1A. Now this subnet is created in 1A. Similarly, I'll create one more subnet for same VPC. Now, can I give something like this? I'll create in 1B. Sorry, the subnet range here. Flipkart VPC subnet 1B. I'm just giving name as private. It is not a private as of now. Now, can I give something like this? This is my VPC CIDR. I'm giving as is. But will it overlap? Will it overlap if I give total? Because did you already created one subnet with, irrespective of availability zone, it doesn't matter. You are creating a subnetwork in another availability zone, in the same network. In the same network, you are creating a one more subnet. But did I already used 0 to 128 IPs, 127 IPs for other subnet in the same VPC? Now, will it overlap? CIDR address overlaps with existing subnet. If you remember, we created already one subnet with this one. One subnet with this one. Right? It is going to overlap with existing one. So now, that's why you use these calculators. Now, can I take this one? Because this is already used for one subnet. Now, can I use this range for another subnet? Here. Again, can I use? I can't start with zero because 0 to 125, it is already used, 128. So that's why I'm saying 128, 0, 128. One second, please. This one. 19.0.0.128/25. Not 24, 25. So 25. Now, this is my VPC. I planned two subnets. So this is one subnet CIDR. This is one more subnet CIDR. But if your requirement says you need to create a four subnets instead of two subnets, can I again split this? Not after creating, you split this before creating. You take this one for one subnet, you take this one for other subnet, you for third one, fourth one, you can take something like this. Now I just planned two subnets. I am creating two subnets. This is in 1B availability zone. Now the subnet has some preferences. The subnet has some preferences, right? Now, if you see, I have two subnets for that VPC, for that Flipkart VPC. One second. For that Flipkart VPC, right? If you see, there are two subnets. This is the subnet range for that one. This is another subnet with this range. Now, can I create a servers in that VPC, Flipkart VPC? Now, since we have a subnets. Select that Flipkart VPC. Now here, do you see two subnets as of now I created? One in 1A availability zone, another one is 1B availability zone. I created these subnets. Now the name is saying public. It is not a public as of now. The subnet will have some preferences, right? If you see, let me select this one. Auto assign public IP. What is the default preference for this subnet? Auto assign public IP. When I select this subnet, what is the default preference? Am I going to get the public IP address as per the default preference? By default, I not get the public IP. I need to select this one. Can I change this preference, auto assign public IP? The moment I select this subnet, it has to be enabled by default. I should be automatically getting a public IP address. Can I change the default preferences? Yes, you can change in the VPC subnet preferences. So here, you select this one, whatever subnet. Here you see, actually how many IPs available if you see now? Total. In this subnet, even though it is 128, actually how many is available? As we discussed, 128 minus 5, 123. In each subnet, 5 IPs will be reserved. In each subnet, 5 IPs will be reserved. Here I have explained. The first 4 IP addresses and the last IP address in each subnet is not available for our use, right? First 4 for this purpose, last IP for network broadcasting, right? So first one for a network address, network ID, the last one for a network broadcasting. And this one reserved by AWS for VPC router, reserved by AWS for DNS server, reserved for AWS for future use. Now I created a subnet and I can change the default preference. If you see the default preference for this one, auto assign public IP. Auto assign public IP. What is the default preference? No. Now if I want to change that preference, I can change, select that subnet, modify auto assign IP settings, enable. And also VPC side also, guys, go to VPC. Here enable DNS host names, enable DNS host names, right? If it is not enabled, guys, if it is not enabled, will I get it like these names? Whenever we see a servers, right, we are getting some host name, DNS name. If it is not enabled, will it be assigned that EC2 hyphen some host names you are getting for your servers? If I don't enable this one for that VPC, will I get a host names, the DNS host names? No. So in the VPC also, go to the VPC. If you want to have a names, internal name, the DNS host name, select this one, enable. So you'll get a host names. Now I have done that, you know, that preferences change. Now if you see, the moment I select that VPC, Flipkart VPC, the moment I select that public subnet, the name is public subnet, do you see it is enabled, auto assign public IP, since I have changed the preferences? Now I can create a server in this VPC, in this subnet. In this VPC, in this subnet, I'll create. Just I'm giving some name. I'm just giving some name. The port 22 is opened. This is the key. Now I am creating a server. Now this server is in which network? Now I created one server. This server. Is the server in the default VPC? Is the server in the default VPC or in a different VPC? Now since I have selected, it is in a which VPC? Flipkart VPC. In this subnet, it is there. If you see the IP, are you getting the IP in that range, whatever range you have given for that VPC, for that subnet, the private IP? Do you see the IP is within that range? Now this is public IP. Even though this server has a public IP, even though this server port 22 is opened for everywhere, will I able to connect now? Let me try to SSH. Will I able to connect? If you understand the concepts, whatever theoretically I have explained. Why I am not able to connect? I will get a connection timeout, operation timeout. Even though the port 22 is open, even though port 22 is opened and I have a access, I mean to say access key, that SSH key. Why I am not able to reach? The server name, you know, I have created in one subnet. Does that subnet has a IGW attached? in the route table? Did we create an IGW first of all to that VPC? What is IGW? What is IGW? Internet gateway. It's a virtual router which will enable the internet connectivity. Now it don't have a route IGW, right? So that's why you'll get an operation timed out. Now go to the IGW section. These IGWs are for a different VPC. So I'm going to create one IGW now. Create IGW. Flipkart IGW. Now I created one IGW. It is not attached to any VPC. It is not attached to any VPC. Now I will attach. Select that IGW. Actions. Attached to VPC. To which VPC? To Flipkart VPC. Guys, whatever we can do from the GUI, I can do from the CLI also. CLI also. Not only just CLI. Whatever I am doing, I am creating a VPC, I am creating a subnets. Will I able to do using Terraform infrastructure as a code? Can I create a VPC, subnets, route tables, IGWs, routing rules? Not only using CLI, can I use it? Can I do it from Terraform infrastructure as a code? Yes. I think I saw someone tried. Someone shared the script also in the group. I don't remember the name. Someone has created a VPC subnet. I think Srikant. Yes. He shared the script also. So whatever I can do. From the console, same thing can be done in the Terraform infrastructure as a code. But if you want to use, if you want to write a Terraform script without understanding the AWS concepts like what is VPC, what is subnet, what is route table, what is IGW, will you be able to interconnect? Will you be able to write those scripts without having a knowledge of cloud? Right? No. Once you are familiar with what is EC2, what is ELB, what is VPC, based on your requirement, you can write a Terraform scripts. For automation, infrastructure as a code. So, I am creating a VPC, I am attaching it to, I am creating IGW, I am attaching it to VPC. Right? Dhruv is asking, most of the time we are going to use AWS only. Not always. But majority of the people are using AWS. But it depends on the project to project, company to company, client to client, right? In one project, I worked on AWS. In last project, I worked on Azure. In the recent project, from last 2 months, I started using Google Cloud. That depends on the client to client. But the concept remains same, guys. In AWS, you call it as a EC2. In the AWS, we call it as a EC2. When you go for a Google Cloud, we call it as a compute, you know, instances. Google compute instances, compute engine. When you go for a Azure VM. When we go for Azure, the server, we call it as a Azure VMs, Azure virtual machines. In AWS, you call it as a VPC. In AWS, you call it as a VPC. When you go for a Azure, you call it as a VNet, virtual network. Here, we call it as a VPC. In Azure, we call it as a VNet. The concept remains same. Subnets, route tables, the terminology is different. The look and feel is different. That's it. Once you are familiar with one cloud, learning the other cloud is very easy. It is like you are using one phone. Let's take you are using Samsung phone. It is built on top of Android. Right? If you are using instead of Samsung, you use Realme, you use Redmi. The underlying concept remains same. the features, the options they are going to provide will be little different. Terraform you can use not only for AWS. You can use Terraform to write automations for Azure instances, Azure networks, or Google. Right? You can use the script. Okay. Hope everyone is clear now. Now let's come back to our topic. Now I have a IGW created, and I have attached that IGW to the VPC. But still, I can't access. Still, I can't access. What is missing? I will go with errors. I don't want to make it success. What is missing? If you understand the VPC architecture, you have a VPC, you have a subnets, you have a IGW. Now, is this subnet has a route to the IGW defined anywhere? Is this subnet is associated with IGW? Anywhere as of now, we have a bits and pieces. Now, if you understand, there is a one more concept in the AWS VPC called route table. In the route table, you are going to define the routing. Network routing, right? You are going to link. Did I create a route table? Did I link the subnet with IGW to make it accessible from internet? As of now, no. So that is where I am going to do route tables. So whenever you create a VPC, you will get one default route table. The moment you create a VPC, you will get one default route table. Already I have one route table. In the route table section, I already have one route table for this VPC. This route table. So if you see the routes, the destination, if this is the destination, the target is local. If someone is trying to access some server, in that one is trying to access some server within this range. The target is local. Suppose I created one server here. Let's consider I created one server here. Now, if this server is trying to access, reach some server on any port, that can be any port, whether it's a database port or whether it's a Tomcat port or Jenkins port, this is trying to access some other server. If the destination is within this range, the destination server is within this range, the target is local. What does it mean? There is already one route. What does it mean? Any server within this range, will they able to communicate with each other without IGW, without internet? Any server, the source is also part of this one and the destination is also part of this one. It is not same subnet, it is a same VPC. Right? If you see, this is VPC CIDR 192.0.0.0/24. It's a VPC CIDR, complete VPC. Whether the servers are in same subnet or in a different subnet, that doesn't matter. Will they able to communicate with each other, whether in a same subnet or different subnet, in same VPC? Will they able to communicate with each other? Yes. Already the route is there. But now I am trying to access from this, my own laptop, this server. Will they need internet connectivity? Will they need a public IPs for a communication? Because my laptop is in different network, the server is in different network. They are not part of same intranet. They are part of two different networks. Do we need an internet connectivity in both the servers? And do they need public IPs for a communication? Now I have a public IP. For this server, I have a public IP. But what is missing? IGW is also there. What is missing? Did I link this subnet with IGW? Route. Route is missing. Right? In the route table, I will do that. I'll create a one more route table. I'll create a one more route table. Flipkart VPC route. Something like this. For this VPC, I'm creating a route table. I just created a route table. But here I need to define the route and I need to do the link. Go to that route table. Create the route. So go to that route table. Go to the route section. Edit routes. Create a new route. If destination is this one, 0.0.0, what does it mean? 0.0.0/0. What does it mean? Any IP in the world, anywhere, any IP. So what should be my target here? Internet. What should be my target here now? What I need to select out of these options? Internet gateway. This internet gateway. Now I just define the route. Do I need to link this route with the subnet here? I just define the route here. One more section is there, subnet association. Here I will link that subnet. Now if I select both, even though name is private, will this become public subnet if I select this one? If I select this one, even though the name is private, will it become a public subnet now? Because we are attaching it to IGW. If I select both, both will become a public subnet. I don't want to make both public. I want to make only this one public. So I am selecting this one. I have done the mapping. Now, your VPC has a route table. The route table has a route to the internet gateway and subnet is associated. Now, will I able to access that server from internet, whatever server which is part of this subnet? If I open the port 22 is open, right? I am able to access. Now, do you see? Am I able to SSH now after doing all these things? Now, this server also has access to the internet because it is part of public subnet. Do you see, is it able to communicate with internet? I'm just pinging Google. Now, do you see, is it able to communicate with internet? I'm just pinging www.google.com. Since it's a Linux server, I'm just using ping. And also, can I directly install the softwares from internet? Package managers in these servers. Suppose something like this. I am trying to install Git software from the package managers. The packages are getting downloaded from internet. Does this server has a internet access now? To and pro, since it's a part of public server. Now, if I create a server in the private subnet, in the same VPC, I am going to create a one more server. In the same VPC, I am going to create a one more server. But this time, this VPC, this subnet, private subnet, I am selecting this private subnet. For private subnets, I don't want public IPs. Now I am creating a server in the private subnet. let me give a label also, some key value pair. So even though port 22 is open for everywhere, will I able to access, even though I have a PEM file, even though port 22 is open, firewall is open for everywhere, will I able to access this server from my laptop? Will I able to SSH this server? Even though port 22 is opened, even though I have a SSH key, will I able to SSH to this server from my laptop? Why I will not be able to SSH? If you see, first of all, the server doesn't have internet. The server doesn't have a public IP. Will I able to access this server from my laptop? Connectivity. If you just want to check the connectivity, what command I can use, whether I am able to connect to that server or not using Linux, right? NSLOOKUP is for getting the, NSLOOKUP is trying to get the IP of your domain, not network lookup. You can use Telnet or you can use ping. You can use Telnet on port 22, IP and port 22, or you can use ping. I will not be able to access this one because it's in a different network. I am in a different network. Now, will I able to SSH directly from my server? If you see, the server doesn't have a public IP, only private IP. Now, from my laptop, will I able to access? Will I able to SSH to this server? Why it is not allowed me to access? Because I am in a different network. The laptop is in a different net. I mean to say, server is in a different network. And there is no internet connectivity. There is no route. So then, how can I SSH to this server? I want to SSH to this server. What are the options? Suppose if I connect to the same network using VPN. If I connect my laptop to the same network using VPN servers, VPN concepts. Using VPN servers, VPN concept, right? Using VPN, I have a VPN server in that network. If I connect to the VPN, my laptop is connected to that VPN. In that case, will I able to access? Because my laptop is also connected to the same network using VPN. That is one option, right? That's how in the real time it works, right? The moment you go to office, you will be able to access your servers. The moment you come to home, you will not able to access. If you want to connect to your office servers from home, what do we do? Do you connect it to the VPNs like Cisco VPNs or any other VPNs? So those are private server. Now this is also a private server, right? So someone is saying NAT. Does NAT does the connectivity? NAT is for a different purpose. I will explain that tomorrow. NAT is for a different purpose. I will explain tomorrow. It's already late. Okay. So now, will I able to, for now, will I able to SSH from this server? I already SSH to one server, which is in the that network. This is a public server. From this public server, will I able to SSH to this private server? This one. Since both are in the same network. Are you getting my point here? In the real time, we call it as a jump servers. In the real time, we will use jump servers. Jump host, jump servers. So I created the server in this. This is private server. This is public server. To this one, I am able to SSH. From this one, will I able to access this one? From here, I can't directly reach this guy. From here, I can't directly reach this guy. But I have reached this guy. From here, will I able to access this one? Since they are in the same network. Yes, you can do that. Right? So from here, I can SSH, but I don't have a PIM file here. I don't have a PIM file in this machine. Let me create a PIM file in this machine. Let me copy my PIM file content to that machine. The PIM file permission should be 400. Now, from that public server, I am trying to access private server. Now I am in that private server. From this public server, I am trying to access the private server. I am in a private server. Since it's in a private subnet, do we have internet connectivity? Is it able to talk to the internet, the server? Is it able to talk to the internet? Do you see? Is it working? No. Can I install the softwares directly from internet now? Now do you see? Is it working? Are you able to download softwares directly from internet? Unless until you have some internal repository. Internal repository servers, you can't do that. So this is a private server. It doesn't have access to the internet. So how do I, you know, make accessible? I mean to say, how can this server requires access to the internet? I am not going to make this server as a public. I am not making this server as a public, but this server still requires access to the internet. Only one way. The server needs to talk to the internet. So now we have a public subnet. The public subnet is attached to the IGW using route table. In the route table, we have attached public subnet to the IGW, so it is getting the access to the internet. The private subnet, I have one private subnet. The private subnets can talk to the other servers in the same VPC. But for this private subnet, if I want to talk to the internet, I don't want to make that private subnet as a public subnet. Still, the servers in the private subnet want to access the internet. In that case, there is a concept called NAT instance, NAT gateway. You create a NAT instance and you define the routing for the NAT instance. Your private server will talk to the NAT. NAT will talk to the internet. This is still private, but this private server will be able to access the internet via NAT. Only one way. We can't reach this server from outside, but the server can talk to the internet using NAT instance. That I will continue tomorrow. It's already late. Okay. So tomorrow I will explain what is NAT instance, and also what is VPC peering. Then I will go for IAM and CLI, guys. Then I will go for IAM and CLI tomorrow. Okay. So this is the last topics in the AWS. This is the last topic. In the AWS, we have two more services, ECR and EKS. This I will explain when we go for a Docker and Kubernetes. Okay. So all our networking concepts, route propagation, edge locations, there are a lot of things, guys. Okay. So VPC peering I am covering, but there are a lot of other concepts. Suppose you want to connect your VPC to the on-prem. Suppose your application server is in AWS and your database server in the your own data center. Will they able to communicate without proper connections? There are a lot of other concepts which I am not covering as part of this DevOps program. Okay, that is required as a AWS solution architect or AWS administrator. If you attend the full AWS course, you will get an idea. What is direct connect, right? And all those stuff. Gautam, this is not AWS course. I am not going to cover cloud formation and all those stuff. Okay. If you need complete AWS, let me know. Okay. There is a separate course for that. This is already too vast. Our syllabus is already too vast. It is going more than 4 months. Okay, guys, that's it for today. We'll continue tomorrow with VPC. Later, I'll start Docker from Monday. Docker approximately 12 to 14 days. Kubernetes approximately 18 to 20 days. This is more important. Last, Ansible 7 to 8 days. So these many days I need. Even though it's a DevOps course, we try to cover AWS for 11 days actually. 11 days, each day 1.5 hours. Almost 17 to 18 hours I covered already AWS. Okay. This course is primarily designed for DevOps, not for the cloud, but as a DevOps engineer also, we should have some knowledge on the cloud. What is server? What is VPC? How it works, right? Because you are going to use those servers to do the CI/CD, right? That's why I thought of covering all these things. So these many days, guys, you can decide like 30 till I need 40 days, approximately 40 days to 45 days to finish the course. Thank you, guys. If you have any question, feel free to ask. Otherwise, I'll continue tomorrow. Tomorrow we'll finish AWS. From Monday, I'll start with Docker. AWS, I am not taking complete AWS session because I am completely tied up with the DevOps courses only. So AWS, there is another trainer called Ganesh. Okay. He works as a AWS solution architect in very big MNC. Okay, he has 7 to 8 years of experience in complete AWS. So he is the trainer for AWS course, complete AWS course. I am not the trainer for complete AWS course because I don't have a time. I am already tied up with all these DevOps courses. Okay. Thank you, guys. We'll see you tomorrow. Python. Again, there is another trainer. He is in the US. Okay, he has very good knowledge on the Python. Currently, he is working in US. So he is taking the classes. He is more than 15 years experience guy. Okay, he has more than 15 years into the programming and Python. So he is going to take care. If you want to go through the demo links, in our YouTube channel, there is a demo for Python. There is a demo for AWS Solution Architect. There is a demo for Azure Administrator. Azure also we are taking. Again, another trainer. You can go through the demos. If anyone is interested, let us know. Okay, the last question, one more guy is asking. Can I use another person also take the same VPC? Guys, VPC is basically your private IPs. I can create more than one VPC with same CIDR. I can only create, not only someone else. I can only create more than one VPC with same CIDR because it's a private networks, right? So private IPs. You can have in the world, you can have multiple servers with same private IP. So I can create a multiple VPCs with same CIDR. It won't be a problem. Any other question? After Docker classes, can we put resume in Naukri? No, sir. Kubernetes is mandatory nowadays, right? Once you are done with Kubernetes, you can upload. Ansible is optional. It is not mandatory. Ansible is optional. It is not mandatory. Once the Kubernetes is done, you can upload your CV. Any other questions, guys? If not, I'll stop the session. We'll continue on next topic tomorrow. Thank you.